but I even didn't like the noise in the hotel where I was
before.
Lim, LIM, SHU, JUAN. Yes, National Gallery.
Okay, thank you.
Cool, thanks.
DUAY, is it? Okay, you're from? Does it?
No.
Why?
You should be because I'm not.
Ah, yeah, better. Better put because
we're. And just hold on. Should be
double check.
Because I really missed the one.
I know yours too.
We'll make sure. She's still very active in all our museums. Despite running her own practice.
Yelling.
Like a star, she became a singer for cinema and American theater museums until they decided to open the arts.
Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Culture Academy's Distinguished Speaker Series with Mr. Bernard Lislin, Director of the National Museum of Modern Art of Centre Pompidou, Paris. To begin, I would like to invite Dr. Alan Chong, Dean of the Culture Academy and concurrently the Director of the Asian Civilizations Museum, to deliver his welcome address and introduce the speaker. Dr. Chong, please.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's my pleasure to welcome Bernard Blisten, the director of the National Museum of Modern Art at the Centre Pompidou, to talk to us today. He's had a distinguished career as curator, educator, and administrator. You can read about this in the CV that's been handed out, but I think it gives hope to us that who started in a more academic line or a more curatorial line, that we can combine these different professions in a fascinating and interesting way. I'd like to just say a few quick words about our collaboration with France, seen to brilliant effect upstairs in the special exhibition that's been prepared in collaboration with the National Gallery of Singapore. In fact, this is an initiative that is part of a larger program, a larger project, that has brought Singapore and France together on a cultural plane in a very interesting way. We're proud the cultural sectors have come together in this way. I'll just give you a few examples, because Singapore has presented a number of exhibitions in France, including Baba Bling, Peranakan exhibition at the Musée du Quai Branly, as well as a contemporary exploration at the Palais de Tokyo. And in turn, we've welcomed wonderful exhibitions, not just the one here, but in previous years, a selection of paintings from the Musée d'Orsay in Paris, a fantastic collection of art from the Congo at the Asian Civilizations Museum. And of course, there's more to come. Please forgive me, but I'll put in a pitch for my exhibitions. Christianity in Asia is opening at the end of May, which depends largely on loans from the Musée du Louvre and the Bibliothèque Nationale de France. We're very proud to be presenting that. And already there's some other plans in the works to, for example, do an exhibition on the art of Nepal with the Musée Guimet. So as you can see, with a little bit of financial and moral and diplomatic support, great things can happen. And I think this is a particularly, this is a peak of this relationship put on by the staff of the National Gallery Singapore and by the Centre Pompidou. So we're very proud of this effort, and I think both museums are to be congratulated for this quite fantastic exhibition. So, with that out of the way, I'd like to welcome our speaker today, who will look at the globalization of the collection of the National Museum of Contemporary Art at the Centre Pompidou, Mr. Bestel.
So, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for being here this wonderful afternoon. Let me first start to thank many of you, Ellen Chang, you know, the director of the Academy, and Mr. Fu Yuhua, who, as the chairman of the National Gallery, has been extremely helpful from the very beginning of this cooperation, and of course, my great friend Jean Tan, director of the National Gallery, for this project, and the staff. As you said, Alan, the two staffs, the staff from Paris and the staff of Singapore. And I have to say that this cooperation has been from the very beginning until yesterday, and let's say for the future, extremely, extremely interesting and brought a lot of signification between the two institutions. Well, I don't know, ladies and gentlemen, if you know about the history of Centre Pompidou and, by the way, the history of Musée National d'Art Moderne. So I'm going to show you quite a lot of slides which will give you some ideas of what was this institution before it became Musée National d'Art Moderne in Paris, right after the war in 1947, and a little bit later when it moved from the former institution to Centre Pompidou in 1977. Let's start to talk about globalization, which, as you know, is such difficult to understand. Let me quote Manuel Castells, the Spanish sociologist who is teaching in Berkeley in the States. Does the global economy aim to transform culture into value exchanges, as it does with everything? It seems to me that such a statement can be a link from the very beginning of this talk until the end. But let's go back to a French history and, by the way, to a context. Who knows about Musée du Luxembourg, which still exists, is still today devoted to exhibition, which is the museum for living artists from the very beginning of 19th century until 1937, which is dedicated to French school. The Musée du Luxembourg, as you can see on these slides, you know, was the first museum dedicated to French living artists. It was founded in 1818 and was the first museum of what we didn't call at that time contemporary art. This institution was, as you can see, devoted to most of the artists who have been involved in Italy and who went back to France as masters, as we said. And the room of paintings of Musée du Luxembourg was a collection of French contemporary artists, which have been acquired very soon. Keep in mind that the French state bought a lot of works from his own artists, but also from foreigners' artists, since the beginning of 19th century. As you see in this other slide, room of sculptures at the Musée du Luxembourg were totally dedicated to the French tradition of monumental sculptures. And the display of the sculptures remains as is until the beginning of the 20th century. The guy who was involved in this collection, who was a real classical man, Léonce Bénédict, who was the director from the end of 19th century until 1925, who was the president of Société des Peintres Orientalistes, which means that he was the president of the Orientalist, you know, painters, has a strong involvement in collecting all these artists. And if you look at some of the works which have been collected, Léonce Bénédict was the promoter, for example, of the Villa El Tif, which was founded at the beginning of 20th century, and which was like the model of the Villa Medici in Rome. And the villa, which was such important for the development of the international relation between the countries, has been active in Algeria until the beginning of the 60s. Could you imagine such a long time, you know, without changing, in fact, of destiny? And under the directorship of Léonce Bénédict, the Musée du Luxembourg acquired a large number of paintings by colonial painters traveling to North Africa and Indochina, including laureates of what we call the Abd El Tif Prize. Among them, you can see in this exhibition here in Singapore, the famous Jean Launois, who spent all his life between, you know, Indonesia and Algeria, and who is one of the key figures who's been involved, you know, in this development of relations between different countries. The other institution which you cannot forget and which is still devoted to visual art is Musée du Jeu de Paume. Musée du Jeu de Paume has been, until very late, the museum for foreign schools, look, between 1922 and 1939. And this institution, which is actually devoted to photography, this institution was the first established as an annex of Musée du Luxembourg in 1922, and the Musée du Jeu de Paume becomes as an independent museum directed by André Desarrois by the end of the 20s, and it collected the works of living foreign artists, and its acquisitions policy is far more span to diversity. And it's totally exciting to look back at what's acquired, because everybody thinks that this globalization started, you know, with the 90s. In fact, if you look back at what has been done at the beginning of the century, you see that there was quite a lot of exchanges between countries. That's in a way something which you can see in the exhibition here in the National Gallery in Singapore. Have a look at some slides. It's always quite funny. The Musée du Jeu de Paume hosts a large number of international exhibitions: Belgium, Switzerland, Denmark, Argentina, Japan, China, Spain, and important artworks join the collection at this occasion. And quite later, most of these works, which remain in the storage, you know, went back to the surface and actually are in view to reconsider, and it's not so far from the title of the show, Reframing Modernism, you know, are part of the reconsideration, you know, of the idea of modernism. Look at this image where you see, you know, the Queen of Belgium for an inauguration. We don't see any more queens and kings in the inauguration. And of course, I regret it quite a lot, as you imagine. So exhibition of Swiss art, you know, at the Musée du Jeu de Paume in the 20s, and the funny thing, the great artist Ferdinand Hodler waiting at the main entrance of the exhibition, which is dedicated to Swiss culture. Something else, look, the cover of the catalog of this exhibition of Japanese art at the Musée de Chaux de Pomme. As you know, for example, and you have a lovely selection of works into this exhibition, some artists like, you know, a great painter as Fujita, who's living in France since the 20s, where he died later. It means that this connection between the countries exists at different level, and that sometimes, even in the Ministry of Culture, people were involved in this direction. Have a look to China's exhibition at Musée du Jeu de Paume in 1933, which is being co-curated, which is extremely interesting to relevant. Could you imagine that in the 30s, in Paris, André Desarrois and Sue Billon co-curated an exhibition. Once again, it dismantles, you know, some ideas, and it brings us in the very truth of what happened before the war. And some artworks have been acquired at this occasion. They are now on a long-term loan at Musée Guimet. And this is something I like, you know, to talk about. Why this work? And this is a question moved from Musée, what was going to become Musée National d'Art Moderne, from Musée National d'Art Moderne to Musée Guimet, which is dedicated, as you know, to Asian art in Paris. There is something we need to consider, why this modernity moved, you know, from its origins and the way to another institution. Isn't it the result of some folkloristic approach, you know, of visual art, which I guess we need to reconsider today when, as we say, we reframe modernism. So look at some artists who are extremely well known and exciting, because I'm just coming back from a wonderful exhibition dedicated to Singapore artists, you know, and there is some links between what we've seen right now and these artists. It means that this deconstruction is becoming a necessity to understand, you know, the real connection between the artists all over the world. And as you see, Guimet is becoming the current location, and this ambiguity of the relationship to these modern artworks is for us today a key point in which myself and the team around me are definitely involved. Many other exhibitions, like from František Kupka and Mucha, exhibited to the Jeu de Paume in the 30s, in 1936, or the very famous Spanish exhibition which starts in 1936, the first year of the Civil War, and the exhibition leads to the acquisition of many different artworks, unfortunately not Guernica from Pablo Picasso, which, by the way, I'm not so sure that he would sell to the French government. But anyway, we acquired quite a lot of artists, and I must say that digging inside the collection brings us quite a lot of information about this exhibition, about the context, and about all kinds of resistance during the Civil War, you know, against, you know, the Spanish government. Another lady, I guess you know, because she is very famous, not only in your country, by the way, Georgette Chen, you know, her work has been acquired very soon, and this landscape with its relations to Cézanne, with quite a lot of Impressionism as a root, you know, for different artists, you know. This work enters probably because we tried to make research and we couldn't find the real date, you know, went to the collection, the museum's collection, at the occasion of the Chinese art exhibition. And Chen's work is also shown in the museum in 1937 at the international room of the exhibition Les Femmes Artistes, the Women Artists, Les Femmes Artistes d'Europe exposent au Jeu de Paume. She was considered as a European artist because, as you know, she lived in Paris. But once again, we were so proud in Paris when we opened, Mr. President, at Centre Pompidou, this women exhibition. Isn't it exciting to consider that even in the 30s, you know, we did exhibition around, you know, the women artists. I'm not so sure that I do like this idea to categorize, you know, men and women, and anyway, it's a little bit for me obvious. But it is the gender situation, you know, which is becoming so strong. But let's say that even in the 30s, there was in mind the idea to do that. So this dialogue between the two institutions, the French artist, the foreign artist, with some confusions, to be frank, remain as is until the opening of Musée National d'Art Moderne in 1947. It is the milestone, definitely. You must know that this institution was supposed to open before the war, more or less at the same time that the Musée, the MoMA, the Museum of Modern Art in New York. But because of the fact that the guy, the director, who was making the collection and who was supposed to open the institution has been involved in the Civil War, when the war went to France in 1939, he had to escape and he couldn't come back. And he went back to France right after the war. And at that time, what did he do? He met quite a lot of artists who were still alive or their estate, and he requested, he was, as I am becoming, you know, beggar, you know, and he requested from all these artists, you know, the works which are the roots of this incredibly beautiful collection. But don't forget also something. Paris has been, from the beginning of the century, a place of exchanges between artists who were coming from all over the world. Why did they come to Paris? For different kinds of reasons. But as you know, after the beginning of modernism with Impressionism, it was more or less a necessity to spend sometimes in Paris. And most of the artists went and stopped in Paris. In the exhibition, you will see three, more than that, five, even more, seven, beautiful Kandinsky. Don't forget that Kandinsky, who was a Russian artist, moved to Germany, became a teacher in Germany between 1919 and 1933, and in 1933, when the Guggenheim family invited him to come to the States, he preferred, as a European, to come to Paris, where he died in 1944. And this is why, you know, all the estate and all the collection joined Centre Pompidou. But this idea of Europe, being in Europe, moving, for example, like Tristan Tzara, the founder, one of the co-founder, you know, of Dada, moving from the neutral city as Zurich to Paris, you know, and exporting, in a way, Dada to Paris, this idea, you know, to make links through Europe between artists and between different places remain such an important, you know, statement that many of these artists, as Picasso, by the way, you know, spent their life in France. So the Musée National d'Art Moderne opened in Palais de Tokyo. Why Palais de Tokyo? Because this building has been built at the end of the 30s for an international exhibition which was dedicated to Japan. So it took the name of Palais de Tokyo. And this building, which I guess some of you know for a while, you know, was divided into two institutions. One on the left, which was dedicated to the city of Paris, and another one on the right, which was dedicated to national institution. And I must say that it remains as is until today. Why? Because the fact that you have now the city of Paris on the left side and the Palais de Tokyo, which is becoming an art center, you know, after the Centre Pompidou became the Musée National d'Art Moderne. Here is a slide of the building. We are in 1937, and a decree provides the replacement of Musée du Luxembourg by the Musée National d'Art Moderne, a museum which was supposed to be located in the new Palais de Tokyo, built, as I said before, for the international exhibition of that same year. And the Musée National d'Art Moderne opened partially in 1942, during wartime, had to close, and totally reopened in 1947. The newly founded musée receives the collection of former Musée du Jeu de Paume. Have a look to some slides, which unfortunately are not so easy to get, with the articles, you know, talking about the structure. Something exciting, this building looks quite classical. This building has been, you know, since the opening of Centre Pompidou, the Musée National d'Art Moderne, and quite traditional, you know, aspects. And such an artist and architect as Le Corbusier fought against the building, wanted to raise this building and to build something else, because he thought that such a building was definitely relating to the tradition. And he was, as you can imagine, against this idea of tradition and considered as this building as a very old-fashioned institution. As I told you, the first director of the museums was the great Jean Cassou, a writer, a poet, who was very close to many artists. And Cassou broke up with the conservative tastes of the Musée du Luxembourg. And if you have any wishes to read the article, they are absolutely crazy, you know, how the fight between the past and this guy, you know, this great gentleman in favor of modernism, you know, including acquisitions and exhibition, has been strong. And he is the one who, for example, took from the estate of the de Roney family, you know, this great works. He's also the one who's been close to Chagall and who could acquire this major works which are in the collection. These works we couldn't acquire even at that time. They became too expensive. And the artworks have been donated by quite a lot of artists. Picasso himself gave 10 paintings to the museum. It means that these people believed in the idea of modernism and wanted, you know, to follow the development of the institution. Braque gave many, many works, and the Kupka and the estate of Kupka gave something like 130 works. Could you imagine? And if you go to Paris now, if you look at the display of the collection, you will see how these works remain definitely the roots of the collection, which means, and it is deeply important even today, that we do not have and that we cannot acquire everything. My friend Catherine David, who is here, you know, say to me, no tutti frutti in the collection of Centre Pompidou. So I will respect, of course, as I did for a while, Catherine David, you know, expectation. By the way, this collection was totally devoted to European artists. Kupka, as I told you, of course, Kandinsky. And you will find this splendid Kandinsky, which is in the middle of the slide, in the exhibition here upstairs. It's a key painting. Could you imagine that Kandinsky, who died in 1944, brought from Germany, when Bauhaus has to close in 1933, quite a lot of works, which even he painted at the beginning of the century, was when he started to be an artist in Munich, in Germany. Could you imagine an artist bringing, you know, from crossing Europe, you know, was his own collection? Many of them went to Paris from the Russian art scene, as Larionov and Goncharova, and we do not have any time to think about it, but could you imagine this artist at the very beginning of the century, around what we call Rayonism, being involved in the very beginning of the avant-garde, moving to Paris and crossing what they did before with the new art scene in Paris. So something which is absolutely exciting to understand, you know, in the process of developing something. And I must say that until present days, the dynamics has allowed Musée National d'Art Moderne to build once again a globalized, you know, collection reflecting the cosmopolitan, once again a very strong word, you know, history of Paris. You know what sometimes people do with such a word as cosmopolitanism, you know the danger which sometimes we feel under the interpretation of such one word. But let's say that it's written, when you look back at the catalogs and at all the books which have been written at that time, that the dream, the expectation, is both to construct, you know, a cosmopolitan history of Paris as a place of encounters and activity for artists, and activity for artists. And this history has shaped the identity, has shaped, no tutti frutti, has shaped the identity of the collection, and it's still significant, you know, gifts, you know, which join the collection. For example, you can see here some acquisitions from 2012 from the great Argentine artist Yuli Cosice. It's hard to explain, but you must know that Yuli Cosice was an artist who was born in the East, who moved to Argentina because he was a Jew. But you must know also that he's been working with the great Italian Argentinian artist Lucio Fontana. So it's all about the history of this globalization, you know, which has been brought by the artist before the market itself. Some views of the display of the collection. As far as exhibitions are concerned, since the opening, the Musée National d'Art Moderne covers international artistic creation. Have a look to the display of the sculptures. Have a look also to this very famous exhibition where you can see what Jackson Pollock, you know, behind the guests, and the famous show, 12 Contemporary American Painters and Sculptors, brought to Paris in 1953. All the glories of this American post-war expressionist abstract painters, we didn't acquire, of course, anything. Why? Because it was like a fight between the traditionalists and between the avant-garde, and the people inside the institution refused to consider these works, which went back to the States. But you can see on these other slides, on the back, quite a lot of fantastic artists like Achille Gorky, you know, who was such a great painter, who was born, you know, at the beginning of this century in Armenia, and we moved with his family to the States, where he became, as many, many of other American artists, one of the leaders of the American art of the post-war. Have a look to the 50 years of art in the United States through the history of sculpture. Look at the tradition of the display of this exhibition. Then something else, which makes me laugh in a way. In the early 60s, in 1964, for example, we gave a huge exhibition to Argentine art. And in the slides, you see the works which went to the collection quite later, at the beginning of the new century. It means that quite a lot of things passed by Paris, but didn't stay in Paris for all kinds of reasons, which you could understand. Have a look at this Cosice's work, which is now in our collection. What does it mean? Is that we were blind, that we couldn't consider the things in another perspective, that we were unable to build, you know, a narrative which could consider the globality of artistic modernism, that we refused it, that we protected it from being part of the world, with quite a lot of questions, you know, which makes sense, especially if you look at the slides in which you see that quite a lot of things have been previously in town before we decided quite later and for a lot of money to acquire. This is the Argentine exhibition. And I didn't have any time to check inside the slides to know if many, many other works joined the collection quite later. But look, something extremely exciting. In 1975, a couple of years before we opened Centre Pompidou, the former National Museum of Modern Art gave a great one-man show to the most famous poet, you know, Mayakovsky, and gave an exhibition which was like a preview of what Centre Pompidou was supposed to do in the following years. And the display of the collection itself, combining, as you see, images, posters, objects, and a lot of information, gives, in a way, another statement, which will become a little bit later the key point of the exhibitions at Centre Pompidou. Behind the Museum Centre Pompidou, the Musée National d'Art Moderne in Paris in 1977. All of you know this image in 1977, when the Centre Pompidou opened, you know, we were going to celebrate, you know, 40 years of Centre Pompidou the next year. But do you know those images of Paris? Do you know those images of, well, let's say the center of Paris? When President Pompidou decided to build an institution in Le Marais, the Swan district, directly in the center of the city. And I do appreciate, if I can say that, that you decided to open your institution here in Singapore, in the center of the city. But if you look at the slides, if you can imagine how this district of Paris has been converted with Centre Pompidou, and how this building had a strong impact on the development of the city, you know, you must imagine how it brought us in another dimension. These are the early display of the permanent collection. I must say that at that time we did with what we had. Well, thanks God it could be worse. When you see the Matisse, Manili, Pevsner, and other artists. But keep in mind that when we opened Centre Pompidou 40 years ago, the collection was around 30,000 works, and that it is now more or less 120,000 works. Imagine what happened in 40 years. And I must say that through this idea, the notion of globalization, you know, was becoming a key point. So this is the presentation of the collection by the great Pontus Sultan when it opened. in 1977. It was an open space. We were supposed to move the walls, you know, and to move the display of the collection a little bit later. Later, it became rigid. And I must say that I have now to work, you know, with the rigidity of the structure. It was a little bit like a balance. Let's say that in the 70s, you know, it was time of performances, happenings, and different open space, you know, art, which was also dealing with the institution itself, you know. It was much better to work with an open space. A little bit later, by balance, you know, it went back to, let's say, a much more classical structure as it is today. But the square, an open space where the visitors could encounter major landmarks of the collection, was the topic at the beginning. As the exhibitions themselves, look at the covers of the catalogs, which, as you know, became the glory of the beginning of Centre Pompidou. No outsiders. Paris, New York at the first one, Paris, Moscow, Paris, Berlin, and at least Paris, Paris. And it has always been for me something funny and sad in a way to open with such, you know, a diversity and to end with Paris versus Paris, some kinds of nationalism, you know. But let's say that these exhibitions have been a real break for the knowledge of contemporary, of modern contemporary art. Some slides from Paris, New York in 77. And I decided to put on the side the cover of the book of the famous French expatriate in the States, you know, Serge Guilbeault, who wrote that book, How New York Stole the Idea of Modern Art. We can criticize that book, but anyway, the idea that New York stole the idea of modern art and brought to the States, you know, which was in fact the beginning of avant-garde in France, remains for many of us one of the strong point of the contradiction between East and West, and remains as some kinds of paranoia between East and West and between Paris and New York, as if everything has been always developed between the two capitals. And this book, you know, has been for me, with quite a lot of critics, you know, but one statement, which of course we cannot forget if you look back at what happened at the turn of the 80s. Some images with the notion of reconstruction, you know, of, for example, the studio of the great Gertrude Stein, who was the great poet living in Paris in the 20s. Another room, dear Catherine, with some paintings by Wilfredo Lam, you know, in the course of this exhibition dedicated to the links between Paris and New York. But, for example, if you look at the trajectory of Wilfredo Lam, you understand that you cannot reduce it to a dialogue between Paris and New York, that you need to go back to Spain, where he went when he decided to leave Cuba, and when he decided later to come to France, and when he went back to Cuba. So it's an internationalism which you need to consider, even if sometimes we reduce it as we do here to such a dialogue between Paris and New York. The same with Kandinsky. This is a reconstruction of Art of the Century, the famous place built by Peggy Guggenheim. Once again, it's just about thinking about the fact, as I said before, that Kandinsky was supposed to go to the States, but decided to make a stop and died in Paris in 1933. And here is again a dialogue between Nouveau Realisme, New Realist, and pop art. And this dialogue once again framed the things between Europe and America. Now we couldn't do that anymore. We need to extend to a much more global, and we much as you said with your exhibition, reframe, you know, this idea of modernism. Another exhibition, Paris, Berlin, in 1978. Look at the display. Look at the main entrance with the plants. It looks a little bit like in a Marcel Brotas exhibition, you know. It's funny how after many years things become, let's say, you know, like a fantasy. But in fact, look at the display, also the things, the reconstruction of the early beginning of the Werkbund in Germany. In fact, Mr. President, quite traditional exhibitions, quite classical display, a collection of masterpieces, which for most of them have been discovered during this exhibition. But look at the perfect symmetry with the Max Beckmann. Look also the old collection of German artists from Berlin. All these slides, you know, give, let's say, a very traditional lecture of modernity. Slides considering architecture, another one which is open to documentation. This exhibition were statements to give to people some knowledge about an extended approach of modernism, but framed modernism inside Europe and American dialogue. Another one was Paris, Moscow, which for many of us was a great discovery. Because we heard about in the 70s some Russian works, but as you know, at that time it was quite difficult to travel in Russia. And quite a lot of this work went after a huge dialogue between the two countries. Paris-Moscou remains as one of the first unusual exhibition. Look at the slides of the display of the collection, which in a way are using the spirit of the Russian avant-garde. The Russian avant-garde which tried to involve the things in many directions, with a political, of course, involvement. And the show tried to restitute the spirit, you know, of this year, like the reconstruction of the monument of the Third International created by Vladimir Tatlin in 1919, or as the reconstruction of the Workers' Club curated by Alexander Rodchenko in 1925. I must say that it is maybe not for the first time, we need to check, but that we agreed to reconstruct, you know, something which didn't exist anymore, to give to people the spirit of the tool much more than a piece of art, and to give to the people the meaning of what was the expectation of this artist at their time. Then went another exhibition, which remains even today as a polemic at the area of the globalization consciousness. The very well-known exhibition, Magicians of the Earth, Magiciens de la Terre, which is, as maybe you know, dispatched between Centre Pompidou, inside Centre Pompidou, and La Villette, another place for exhibition. This exhibition, for many of them, and for, let's say, many of us as curators, including Catherine David and myself, was in a way quite a difficult exhibition. I must say that it is maybe an exhibition which tried to put together artists from all over the world. But it seemed to many of us that the lecture was all being thought from our point of view. and that we didn't have the capacity, you know, to, as we say, make a step on the side, to consider, you know, the situation from another perspective. So the result of the exhibition was certainly quite a lot of artists and lists of artists, which combined artists from here, as we said, and artists from there. But isn't it too reductive in a way, you know, to consider artists from here and there? And isn't it, you know, a little bit limited, you know, to consider or too folkloristic or too, I'm sorry, neo-colonial, you know, to build an exhibition as, you know, such a dialogue between here and there? And in the exhibition you could find a lot of display and installation, and let me show you a slide which for me makes sense. This is a slide from an installation view at La Villette, the other part of the exhibition. And as you see, the image shows a Richard Long piece from 1988 and another piece from, New Guinea, Yundumu community. Does it make sense for you, or isn't it what I would like to call pseudomorphism, you know, to put together two works with such different significations? Isn't it too reductive, you know, to put together two works because of the fact that two of them are made with round pieces, with circles? Isn't it a too formal artist? And in this formalism, isn't it like the limit of what I would like to call like a neo-colonialism? The same with such one work by the great South African artist Esther Malangu, you know, her house, which is a house which is made for, you know, the boys. It's a circumcision house, you know. And the house has been reconstructed, but thanks God we didn't circumcise anybody, you know, during the exhibition. And by the way, for me it was too late. But let's say that, I must say that, does it make sense to build, as we say, in cars, you know, in the middle of the exhibition, without thinking displacement and signification, you know? So this exhibition, Magicien de la Terre, is, of course, you know, an important exhibition for, let's say, the statement of the curator, but was also such a source of debates, you know, which remain, even today, for me, a key point in the development of the globalization inside the Centre Pompidou. Look, this is Mr. Malangu. She was building her house in front of everybody during, you know, the construction of the exhibition. I must tell you that I heard and that I knew that such a house cannot be built in front of everybody. It has to be built in one specific context. Once again, the context, which we cannot forget, you know, when you do work in a global, you know, perspective. Then the Centre Pompidou developed quite a lot of exhibitions. Alors la Chine, I love the title, Alors la Chine, and So What China, you know, and Africa Remix, which looks a little bit like, a disco title, you know, Africa Remix, you know. Then another one, Promesse du Passé, which was devoted to East of Europe. And another one, you know, Paris, Delhi, Bombay, which was supposed to be like a dialogue between India and between French culture, trying to reinforce what we talked about before. Something like, in a way, brought us a few years later to another exhibition, which in a way was an attempt to answer to globalization, Modernité Plurielle. Modernité plurielle has been built at the beginning of this century in 2012 until 2014 and was a new display in the permanent collection. This exhibition brought back quite a lot of works from the storage. This exhibition restored quite a lot of works we've been talking about before, the one which has been bought in the 30s, the one which refers to the colonial past of France, and mixed the things in one extremely intense display. Have a look. Covering the walls with the covers of the review, mixing quite a lot of works coming from different exhibitions in order to reconstruct, you know, the spirit at the beginning of the exhibition in Les Salons, you know, and at the beginning of the century. Bringing also information on, let's say, great collectors or artistic collection, like, you know, the Kandinsky collection, which is mixing all the objects and the folkloristic, you know, aspect of the things and the visual art. Trying to make like a specific statement combining objects and also sculptures. And such an exhibition trying also to put together different artists, like here on the slide, you know, some artists from North Africa with the native African artist Atlan. And such a painting is in view in your exhibition. Or bringing also artists from different country to develop some statement about modernism. To me, such an exhibition, I must say, was a little bit confused. The legitimacy of the exhibition was definitely to bring back quite a lot of stuff and to rediscover quite a lot of works. But the question was definitely not only to put all the things together, but was definitely to try to reframe, again the word, you know, to reframe them inside their context. And I must say, my dear Catherine, that's what you tried to do with your Documenta, you know, Documenta 10, which was a critical and theoretical alternative to many things we discussed before. Something which was also closer to the spirit of different intellectuals. I was thinking about Stuart Hall, for example, who was at that time one of the key points, you know, to develop, let's say, a critical statement about the exhibition itself and, let's say, about what we're supposed to do. And such an exhibition, its catalog, and the famous 100 Days, where Catherine decided to invite critics, historians, writers to discuss about, you know, our time, you know, brought in the exhibition itself something which remains for us another key point. And I must say that I'm very proud that Catherine decided to come back to Centre Pompidou and to become in charge of this horrible word, this globalization, you know, which I guess she refused to use. Some slides of the catalogue, some slides also of the exhibition itself, you know, the Peter Kogler great display, you know, and the Michelangelo Pistoletto display in one of the buildings of Documenta. Or, you know, this great leader artist, Elio Tishika, you know, with whom Catherine has been working. She never met him, he died before, but anyway, she did an exhibition in Paris at Musée du Jeu de Paume a few years before with, you know, this installation project from the early 60s. It seems to me that from art history to history of presence, we need to build a museum for multiple voices. And let me carry with you, you know, this small text from Stuart Hall, which in a way can resume a few things which I try to develop. trying to focus on developing new interpretative frames, history of exhibitions, curatorial studies, postcolonial studies, to write and to rewrite art history means considering it as a palimpsest of different discontinuous narratives, stories which overlap without mixing with one another. Let's say that such a statement can help to reconsider what we would like to do actually with the Centre Pompidou. Here is the new display of the modern collection, and we decided when we acquired this great works from Marwan, the Iraqi Berliner artist, you know, to install it at the main entrance of the building. Here is, of course, the new display which brings us inside the Prohm collection, which we try to respect, you know, the context and to contextualize, you know, most of the works of the collection. Here are what we call the exhibition dossier, which are dedicated to thinkers, to art historians, to critics, as you can see with the following images, including Robert Lebel, Alain Jouffroy, De Gageon, Aimé Césaire, or even Oswald de Andrade, who is one of the leaders of the notion of anthropophagy in Brazil, you know, in the 30s. These exhibitions try to combine different objects, but this exhibition tries to be, let's say, statement. Tries, as I said before, quoting, you know, Stuart Hall, try to build, you know, a history of exhibitions themselves, and try also to consider, you know, this narrative, you know, with their own specificity. Look how you can, you know, dispatch inside, you know, the Prohm collection, a global lecture, you know, one writer as Alain Jouffroy, the French writer, who spent all his life, he wrote something like 120 books, combining different kinds of perspectives in history of art. Look how a museum can become one place to learn, one place to educate, one place which is not only under the fascination of images, can become really some place to educate eyes, but also to think about, you know, the content of art. For example, we did something on the Gedeon to German writers. He was involved in architecture, she was involved in sculpture. And they really built as a definition of modernism, mixing artists around different notation, which brings back to, well, let's say, modernity, to the spirit of technology. Look, for example, also to these other rooms, which are dedicated to great, you know, people who were involved with literature or with even bookstores, at the famous bookstore which maybe somebody knows here, La Une in Paris, which crosses such a lot of informations. Bring information inside the museum. Bring information with Aimé Césaire, the writer who is connected, you know, to many other artists as Picasso, and who is a leader, you know, of negritude, and who has to be considered as one of the key figures of the decolonization. Look at these rooms, mixing, as you see, words, but also books. Here on the right, you know the Cuban artist Wilfredo Lam, or even photographies. Once again, use the museum as one place to think and try to keep the museum far away from the society of spectacle in which it can bend, actually. Some images again from Aimé Césaire. And here is another selection of slides. I prefer to show you a lot of slides. You know, it gives information about the scenes, including Osvaldo de Andrade, including Tarsila de Amaral, and including this context of anthropophagy, you know, which became in the 30s one key point of resistance versus, you know, the idea of decolonization. By the way, if you pay attention, you will see that such a great French poet as Blaise Sandor has been linked and has been involved with all these things. And he considered himself as a traveler. He said, "I am a bourlingueur," which means that he traveled all over the world. And he was one of the leaders who brought to Paris, including to Fernand Léger, you know, this artist, to make some links between different cultures. Another example is one of the last rooms which we dedicated to the great French writer Hubert d'Amiche, who tried to work about perspective, history of art, and who tried really to build a narrative which in a way tried to mix architecture and visual art, looking at the flat dimension of painting, combining, you know, for example, Jackson Pollock, and as you see, Mondrian. The museum as a statement, the museum as one place where you don't show only a collection of trophées, a collection of works which you acquire as a demonstration of power. Let's say power versus authority. Another exhibition which brought us in this de-definition of modernism, the exhibition which Catherine made on Wilfredo Lam, with some slides about the exhibition, the display of the works, and the history of the artist, you know, who was born, as I said before, Cuban, who moved to Spain, who developed his work in Paris. We discovered African art in Paris. We went later, you know, to Cuba, who went back to Europe. And an artist as a key point to understand and to reconsider, you know, the way of using art, you know, in a political perspective, much more than in just an aesthetic perspective. Or let's say using aesthetic as ethic, in a way. The corridor with, you know, the history, and when you follow the history of such an artist, you follow also the artist inside or in the middle of the terror of modernism and in the terror of the history, you know, of the century. Here on the right side, you know, the famous painting, The Jungle, which belongs to the collection of Museum of Modern Art in New York, which has been acquired by the Museum of Modern Art in New York in the early 40s, but which, as Catherine explained, remained during such a long time, you know, in a corridor, because it couldn't be included in the narrative which they tried to develop. The painting itself, which escapes in a way, you know, from the reductive narrative which American artists and American critics tried to build. Another example of what we try to do right now, giving an exhibition to the Indian architect Raj Rawal. And reconsidering the relation between modernism and Le Corbusier and, you know, Indian architecture. And once again, trying to deconstruct, you know, the perspective in which such an artist has been influenced by Le Corbusier. You must also reconsider what he did as influential on Le Corbusier himself. So you see through all the slides the development of the collection, both with the development of, you know, the exhibition. Let's end this short, or too long, who knows, presentation with some perspectives in which we are actually involved and in which we try to develop some new statements. We are going to work on Bangladesh. We are involved in the Dhaka Art Summit, which, as you know, is becoming an extremely important statement for architecture. We are going to develop with the Dhaka Summit a reflection about architecture in Asia and its links with European culture. One of the curators of the team brought back, you know, from his exploration quite a lot of unknown figures, and the Dhaka Art Summit will be for us like a statement for the next feature. Here are some images of the exhibition which we started to curate in Dhaka before bringing it to Paris. Another project is coming soon. The title is Baby Elephants Die Alone, Rapture, War and Surrealism in Egypt. This show will show, you know, the relations and the strong impacts between surrealism and Egyptian contexts, let's say between the war, and will consider or will help to reconsider the modernity of many Egyptian artists who've been at that time, you know, like a combination between what they knew or what they discovered or what they tried to interpret from surrealism with their own culture. One of the key leaders of the group was the great writer and journalist, you know, George Enain, and he was one of the co-founder of this movement, Art and Liberté, a group which, as you see, has been created as in 1939 until 1946. But have a look to some of the images. Have a look to these artists who are for us, and I must say, for me, despite the fact that I'm supposed to know not everything, not tutti frutti, but let's say, to have a global lecture of the world, these artists who remain for me totally unknown, Abdel Ghazar, this combination of his own mythology with something which, by the way, we don't have to call anymore surrealism, which we don't have to put under the umbrella of surrealism. Surrealism as a key word which everybody understands, but which in a way doesn't reflect the contact and even the expectation of the artist himself. Look at some other images. Look at these incredibly beautiful works by Fouad Kamel, a painting for the early 50s, and try to consider the famous question of chronology, which all of us, we thought was definitely the key point to understand the meaning of modernism. Are we facing with some dyschrony? Are you facing with a redefinition of modernism? Do we have to consider again and again modernism through this notion of rupture? Do we have to reconsider the things from the context from where it has been provided? Look at these works. Here is one work by Inge Eflatun, and there's an irony in a way to look at these works and to see how sometimes they look definitely more intense, but closer to some of the reaction which happened in the European culture in the 80s when we moved back into what we call postmodernism. And look at such a face, you know, from Mahmoud's side, which is like, you know, the key iconography, you know, of the Egyptian girl in the context of the pre-war. Ramses Yunan, one of the famous artists of this generation, and Aleph Rayes with works, you know, which are deeply important in the political context of such an exhibition, which I suppose will be one of the most exciting projects which we are going to develop in the following months, just because of the fact that it brings us in another dimension, in another political context, just because of the fact that it doesn't reduce, you know, one lecture of modernism to a red thread in which us from Europe, we should be the beginning and the end. Another example was the famous artist Rauda Shoker. Another project which I would like to mention, we do work on Beirut as a ville monde, as a city world. Why? Because as I told you before, we knew that from the very beginning when Centre Pompidou opened, it decided to concentrate in the dialogue between East and West, neglecting, you know, the other dimension of a global world. With Beirut and with the artists who have been involved in the Beirut avant-garde until the Civil War, like Marwan Hashmawi, or even like the great collection of the Fouad Debbas collection of photographies and postcards, with many other names, who talks about the mutations of Beirut, or with such a photographer as Hisham Madani, we open the collection and the exhibition together, themselves, to another perspective. The last slide will be let's say, an open project which actually we're deeply involved with. A team is actually working on a new project which the title will be Cosmopolis. Let's say that, as we say in French, le titre dit bien ce qu'il veut dire. The title describes precisely what he wants to be. Cosmopolis is a project which wants to select quite a lot of collective artists working all over the world. Let's say fighting maybe against the institution itself and and building their own structure as an answer to an institution which cannot reduce its activities to what happens inside the building itself. Thank you very much, and sorry to be so long, but it seems to me that such a question has to be discussed for a very, very long time.
Because you mentioned also the difficulty of the architecture of the Renzo Piano, Richard Rogers architecture, and the challenges that this may bring up, and how you might be considering refining this display. But I was fascinated by the exhibitions from the 70s and 80s, these fantastic run of shows of Berlin, Moscow, New York, and they brought back very happy memories of these, what I thought were the most wonderful exhibitions at that time. But to see the photographs, it struck me so powerfully that the shows, in their concept as well as their presentation, and even in their graphics and display, responded to the building, rather carefully and profoundly. I mean, even things like the poster designs and the presentation of the shelving and the displays. And I guess I share the interest in this sort of openness and portability of the old walls that were part of the original concept. But and even the strange struts that make up the roof, do you think there was on the part of the early curators from the 70s an attempt to respond to the building consciously, unconsciously? And do you think, the second part of my question is, are you going to change the galleries? Are you going to do anything that returns to the original concept, or disguises it even further, or doing something totally different?
Don't forget that the building has been built, from the 60s until it opened in 1977. There's a strong dialogue between the architects, Renzo Piano and Richard Rogers, and the first director of the institution, Ponti Sultan. So as you said, there is definitely a link between the building itself, its flexibility, and the institution. And I must say that, as you said before, the exhibitions, I don't know the answer, but they continue, the process of keeping an open space to built a statement on the museum itself. It means that in a way, when Centre Pompidou has been built, it was not only a museum. Something which I forget to say, I forgot quite a lot of things to say, but which I guess is deeply important. When Centre Pompidou opened, quite a lot of artists, quite a lot of widows, quite a lot of estate refused to send their works to Centre Pompidou because they considered that it was like a critical institution which it has to remain. These works joined the collection later, but I must tell you that between the end of the 70s and the beginning of the 80s, there was quite a lot of fights to convince this family to send their works, which they gave before to the Centre Pompidou, which they didn't consider as a museum institution. And let me say that, in a way, the Centre Pompidou is being built to be not only a museum, but to be a combination of different activities, which was, in a way, the specificity of the Centre Pompidou, which I'm not so sure that you could find anywhere else, even today. So, of course, there was a strong relation between the display of the exhibition and the building itself, which is being considered and which is being built as a critical device, as a machine, if you want. Don't forget that the Centre Pompidou has been built when Gilles Deleuze and Félix Guattari wrote Thousand Plateaus. You know that there is some connection between, let's say, the conceptual dimension of Centre Pompidou, which of course has been influenced by the great Archigram and by all the avant-garde, the neo-avant-garde of the English architects from the mid-50s, Alison and Peter Smithson, and all these, you know, great architects and thinkers. But let's say that when the Pompidou has been built, it has been built as an open and modulate space which had to remain like that. A little bit later, in the mid-80s, when, by the way, Catherine David and myself became young curators, even if we were still very young, became young curators at Centre Pompidou, we knew that Dominique Bozo, who was the director, decided to convert, you know, this flexibility into the classical building. Once again, the question of the Y cube. You don't have to read Brian O'Doherty to understand what it means, but the Y cube. And quite a lot of people, including the curators, requested, you know, at that time, walls. We need walls. Please, director, give us walls. I must say that it was connected to the return, if I can say that, to the painting, or to the painting as a model. Let's say that there is a strong relation in the 70s between informal performances, happenings, and infiltration of different kinds of activities inside the museum itself. And later, when, of course, in the mid-80s, you know, with this return, with this commercial return to painting something framed, you know, with, you know, the volonté to reframe the building itself. So what are we going to do? Well, I think that we've adapted the building to different possibilities. When we reinstalled the collection a year ago, we dismantled quite a lot of walls. We tried to reopen it on the city, to build the dialogue between inside and outside, the famous streets, you know, which was supposed to bring the people from outside to inside. And I must say that we try, both with Mr. Lasvin, to clarify these things, to make it more open, and to build with every exhibition a statement and the exhibition itself.
Your dialogues with leading thinkers and critics, do you see that as part of this response to return to the openness and the discussion of the early Pompidou, or is this something a completely different set of...
The Pompidou has always been in dialogue with all those critics. I guess that the Pompidou has always been as a key space, you know, for all kinds, you know, of interventions and visiting artists and visiting, you know, teachers. And we love to do that. And I must say that I do love, as we did here in Singapore, to build binôme, you know, you know what I mean by binôme? By two teams, dialogues, you know, between people. And for example, for different exhibitions, we try to bring, you know, people, not like outsiders, but we try to bring people who've been involved with the context which we'll try to exhibit. There is a book which I forget, well, how can I translate it, you know, which is for me, which remains for me, a key book which I read in the early 80s by Nathan Vetchel. I don't know if you heard about the name, you know. He was a great well as an anthropologist, you know. He was one of the students of Claude Lévi-Strauss, and the title of the book was La Vision des Vaincus, the vision of, how do we say that, La Vision des Vaincus. The defeated people, yes, the vision of defeated people, which is for me, which remains for me one of the key books which I never forgot, because it brings the necessity to bring some energy from outside. And that's why I tried to criticize, let's say, in a positive way. It's just because of the fact that I consider an exhibition and what we do as critical statements and not like adoration. I don't adore anything in my life, you know. And anyway, it seems to me that an exhibition we need to bring some critical statement. And it seems to me that if you do things with outsiders, you bring both this energy and this dialogue between two different contexts.
So, questions from the audience. Lots of interesting ideas.
Or maybe, if you may, some addition from the people of the exhibition themselves.
Anyone wants to.
Catherine or some people who want to
but
add
perhaps
something.
Perhaps the audience has a question.
I don't know.
Comments?
Catherine, would you like to say something? I don't want to disturb you. No, anyway. Some people?
Shall we call on people? We can do that. Come, lots
the first
of
one is always the worst.
People here. So, oh, yep.
The first question is always the most difficult.
I know you spoke with regret about some missed opportunities in terms of your acquisitions. I'd like to hear a little bit more, you know, in a contemporary way, what you think of that and how it influences your own acquisition policies now.
Mm-hmm. Quite a huge question. Yes, of course, we miss a lot of things, but in a way we don't care. Well, it's just the result of the past and just the result of history and contradictions. We were not ready, by the way, to acquire these works, despite the fact that they've been, you know, exhibited, as I told you, in Paris before. But we were not ready. Why? Because it was not part of the narrative which we tried to build. So we considered that, some people considered that these artists had to be shown, but they consider these artists as outsiders. I mean, they consider these artists as not part of what they need to describe as, well, you know, their ideas of modernism. So what do we do today? We try to focus on a more precise way of, on different, you know, contents. We try, as I explained you, you know, for example, with surrealism in Egypt, or with the Bangladesh, you know, exhibition, to see where are the connection, even the disconnection between their context and our context. And if we collect these works, which we try to do, we're not going to include them definitely, you know, in a narrative like a link, you know, with a beginning and in the end. But we'll try to exhibit them as we do, as a step on the side. Because if you do that, you know, it seems to me that you bring the complexity of the history of art. And the thing we try to fight against is to reduce, you know, the history of art to a quite simple narrative where everything becomes clear, where everything starts to be obvious. The question is definitely to bring complexity, because if you bring complexity, you bring, let's say, much more, you know, attempt, you know, to, well, let's say, what we have to be, what we have to do and what we have to be.
Some people, however, like simple narratives, a beginning, a middle, and an end, a written collection policy. So how do you, for example, tell a funder or a sponsor or a government official that what you're doing is complex, contradictory, and full of sideways and byways outside a clear narrative? And do you write all of this out?
I do work with the president of Centre Pompidou, and we do work together, and it's enough. We're not going to spend, you know, and I like it, and I respect, this dialogue quite a lot. But I must say that we do not talk to everybody. Let's say that despite the fact that we need to build, you know, a narrative, despite the fact that it seems to me that forever Cubism will start before Surrealism, which it's, well, is maybe some chronological point of view, you know. But, alphabetical, I'm totally against. Alphabetical, it's totally something, it's cynicism. And I love irony, and I prefer humor, but cynicism versus the artist and versus the works themselves, I don't care, and even I don't like it at all. But let's say that, well, let's say when you proceed by movement, when you proceed by, you know, sections, when you try to enlarge, you know, the section to the dialogue between artists and between different contexts, you know, by keeping, yes, some kinds of development, you give to people the possibility to understand, you know, or to be involved and with, you know, the history of art. I believe in history of art. I do know that history of art has been invented, that it didn't fall from the sky. I do know that there is a history of art, and there is like a storytelling of history of art. But despite the fact that I know that, it seems to me that if you want to bring inside this complexity, you need to do that by focusing your activities on different artists who have been linked with, as we say, de près ou de loin, with our culture. And for example, what I tried to, you know, to identify from, let's say, Beirut, you know, we do know how Beirut has been for quite a lot of people in Europe one of the key points, you know, of the dialogue between cultures. If we do something as we're going to do on Bangladesh, well, it seems to me that it explains the connection between some idea of architecture internationale, international architecture, and the vernacular dimension which some architects from India brought into this dialogue. Do I answer? No, I didn't talk about the, you know, fundraising. Fundraising. We are always ready for fundraising, you know, fundraising. please help.
Eugene?
Thank you, Bernard, for your very interesting talk. Well, we've seen you talk about your future exhibitions and programs extending to the Middle East and South Asia. Can we see other parts of Asia becoming part of your future programming as well?
But can I answer something simple? We've seen and identified by working with your staff and with our staff, with Nicolas and Catherine, we've seen some artists from your country which we would definitely like to bring to Paris. We like to give them like a small one-man show in which you can explain, you know, what they tried to do, what was the context, and even the complexity again, you know, of what they did. And let's say that if we can do that together, I will be very happy. So anyway, it's not going to be reduced to south of India, whatever, you know. It's like a lot of, how do we say, chantier, you know. I do love what André Breton and René Char wrote in the 20s when they say ralentir travaux, slow down, you know, we work, slow down, we work. And it seems to me that if you need to slow down with the museum, time is passing so fast, we are always, all of us, in a rush. It seems to me that the museum institution by itself is definitely one place where you need to slow down.
Do you have any plans to look beyond individual cultures? I mean, I think this is a trap that we fall into. I know in my experience is that the public understands this place and time. And to do a sweeping conceptual show like Magicians of the Earth is fraught with danger. But I'm wondering if you have any plans in this area to look at a way to connect many different things together on a conceptual level.
You mean to fraught with danger? I guess we do every day. And when you see, well, the titles of the exhibition we're actually involved with, I must tell you that we're really flirting with danger. Well, once again, I considered, you know, Magicien de la Terre as an exhibition on which we have to discuss. By the way, 25 years after this exhibition, we decided, you know, not to celebrate it, but to bring a statement on it. And during 10 days, we brought some new curators who, by the way, didn't see the exhibition because they were too young at that time, you know, to discuss about the exhibition itself, about the expectation, what the exhibition tried to be, what the exhibition wasn't, why it wasn't, why such a guy as... I must tell you something. Do you know that Magicien de la Terre has been sought not by Jean Bernardin, but by Pontus Hulten, the first director of Centre Pompidou, Musée National d'Art Moderne, without European artists. The first statement of Magicien de la Terre, yes, was an exhibition which was not trying to confront, you know, artists from, you know, our continent. And he moved into this direction. But I do know that at the beginning, it was like an exploration, despite the fact that I don't like the word when you talk about artists, we were coming from everywhere. But anyway, it was at the beginning an exhibition which was supposed to give different kinds of examples of modernism in different contexts. But it was not supposed to associate, you know, this artist with what I call pseudomorphosis, you know what I mean, in a formal way. And, well, let's say that Magicien de la Terre remains, you know, one statement at one time, but you cannot forget that many, many critics, writers, art historians have been involved, you know, in these questions quite a long time before. I was talking about Claude Lévi-Strauss and many, many others. We need also to consider some great writers, you know, who've been involved from different continents, from India, from different countries, you know, and who were definitely not shocked, but they were a little bit confused with the fact that such an exhibition was definitely a single point of view. So what do we do? Well, let's say that next exhibitions we try to do some new format as what we're going to try to do with this Cosmopolis, which is a big discussion inside, which is a lot of, well, let's say, dialogues between people inside the Pompidou, people who like it, people which refuse it. Well, all these things bring the museum, well, in its energy. And let's say that, as we say, on apprend en marchant, I guess. You learn when you walk. Do you say that in English?
Learn by doing, maybe. A little.
Learn by doing is not learning by walking. And but anyway, for me, it's absolutely important to consider such an institution which combines all these activities, yep, as a platform, as a platform. I don't want to say it just as an experimental platform because it's a little bit pretentious and things sometimes have to be light, you know. But I do like things which are light. But it seems to me that combining such a collection which is such a deep collection with archives, books, etc., combining diversity of activities, design, architecture, photography, whatever, all the disciplines, including, as you know, one key structure for contemporary music, including this huge public library, including, you know, all these levels, all these stratifications of signification. The Pompidou, and the great challenge of Centre Pompidou is to remain, you know, one place for discussion.
Many arts together.
Yep.
Thank you, Bernard, for this very expansive talk and also, you know, the show that you and your colleagues have put up, which has, I would hope, you know, to help open a lot of minds to this, you know, intermingling of the two galleries in how we present art. So I just want to know from you, certainly for the National Gallery as well as for myself, how this experience, what insights have you gained that you can share with us that we should take away and learn from this exhibition effort that we've both come together to, you know, present?
Sir, let me first thank you in front of everybody for your help and your involvement, both with the gym and once again with the staff. Well, the first thing which I learned has to do with your great professionalism and with the great pleasure to share, you know, the things and the idea together. I remembered when Eugene and the two curators went to Paris and when we started to discuss, at the very beginning we didn't know yet what we wanted to do. We knew that you brought quite a lot of images, documentations, and anyway, and as you saw in the exhibition, we tried to combine, you know, and to develop as a statement, mixing, you know, dialoguing, you know, between the things. So something which I learned is the real necessity, to develop different things out of your own context. To once again, something which I repeat maybe too many times, you know, make a step on the left, which means definitely that it is the only way to deconstruct and reconstruct another narrative. So we do it in one specific country, as Singapore, because I must say that you went to us because I guess you knew maybe that Centre Pompidou was, let's say, some unusual, you know, structure with which you liked to work. But I must say that if definitely I learn from this experience something, let's say that it is that the show must go on, which means that things have to be developed. It means that, as I said before, this artist, which has been identified by the two teams, and by Catherine and by Nicolas Lucci, you know, that these artists have to be exported, you know, to be brought, you know, to Centre Pompidou to enlarge, you know, the narrative and to enlarge, you know, the redefinition or the de-definition, you know, of the history of art. So let's do our best to follow and to develop different things, as by the way, we try to do in different kinds of contexts, you know, by opening, it's not Pandora, but by opening, you know, a dialogue, a cultural and intellectual dialogue between, you know, two contexts.
Well, thank you very much. That's a fantastic lecture and a very interesting dialogue. And if anyone has more questions, we have a bit of a reception. Thank you very much. That's fantastic.
Thank you.
They are employed,
and,
but not employed.
Yes. Yeah.
That's it.
Thank you.